Okay, so let me explain first in very briefly, you know, what is the motivation of my talk. So it's a joint work with Katia Consani, and very recently we made one discovery which I had been sort of expecting for many, many years. I mean, in 96, you know, I found a non-commutative space which was allowing one to write, if you want, the explicit formulas of Riemann-Weyl as a trace formula. And of course, at this time, you know, I was hoping that this setup would give some information about the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. But after a while, after working quite hard, I found out that, in fact, what was happening was like in physics, namely the zeros, which may exist not on the critical line, manifest themselves also in a kind of positive manner through resonances. So gradually, I realized that there was not enough algebraic geometry in the setup, and that what was missing was, if you want, kind of a very elementary, fundamental algebraic geometric structure that would be underlying the same non-commutative space. And so with the Consani, we found at some point a few years ago, this was in 2009, that in fact it was possible to understand the counting function for this hypothetical curve, if you want, and that there was a lot of consistency going on, and that was actually involving the limit when q goes to 1 of you know, geometries over FQ and ideas which have been developed since a very long time, in particular by Jacques Tietz. But okay, this was still very, very far from anything concrete. And very recently, we found what I hope to be an answer to this conceptual question. And it turns out that the answer involves two fundamental notions, which are not completely obvious. The first notion is the notion of a topos, which is due to Grothendieck. And the second notion, which will play a crucial role, is tropical geometry, or if you want, characteristic one. Okay, and they will be involved in a way which I will explain right away, but which is, as you will find out, I mean, if the answer was very complicated, it would be worth nothing. And so I will explain the answer. And the answer is remarkable by its simplicity. So I will explain what is this arithmetic site. So it has this arithmetic site is as a space, it's a topos. So I remind to you that Grothendieck generalized topological spaces by the following idea, that by the idea that in fact you can encode the topological space almost entirely by the category of sheaves of sets on the topological space. Okay. So in other words, when you have a topological space, of course you can consider sheaves of sets, just sets, that's enough. And they form a category. And as Grothendieck noticed, the category of sheaves of set not only, of course, gives you back the topological space, but in the right manner. For instance, if you take the topological space, which is obtained from a variety by looking at the Zariski topology and not knowing about schemes, when you will compute the corresponding topos of sheaves of sets, and when you will look for the points of this topos, you will find the points of the scheme. Now, but Grothendieck understood that somehow, if you want, there were more categories of sheaves of sets than topological spaces. And among them, in particular, and this is evident when you read SGA4, there are, if you want, toposes which are obtained as dual of small categories. So you take a small category and you take all possible functors, contravariant functors, from this small category to the category of sets. It turns out that the corresponding category has exactly the same properties as the category of sheaves of sets on a topological space. And this is what we shall do here. So here, the small category that we shall take is amazingly simple. It's just a category which has only one object. but the endomorphism of this object is the semigroup of non-zero integers under multiplication. So this is a small category. And at the end of my talk, sorry?
You wrote n plus, it's usually positive.
Yeah, positive. Oh, yeah, oh, sure. No, my integers are always positive, okay? So it's a very, sure. Okay, so it's positive integers. So, I mean, what is an object? This topos is a topos of functors from this category to sets. But of course, since it has only one object, it will give you just a set with an action of n cross. And at the end of the talk, I will explain the link with non-commutative geometry of this space. I mean, this space is, in fact, exactly the absolute point in non-commutative geometry. So, but it has a structure sheaf. And it is this structure sheaf which involves topological geometry. So what is a structure sheaf? The structure sheaf has to be an object of the topos, because it has to be like a sheaf on topological space. And as an object of the topos, moreover, it has a structure. And that structure is a structure of a semi-ring of characteristic one. What is it? It is all positive or zero integers, where you add infinity, so you adjoin infinity. Okay, and the operations are the following. The first operation is the infimum. So if you have two integers, one of them is the smaller. Okay, so this is what will replace, if you want, in this semi-ring, the sum. And the other operation is a plus. So it is a plus which plays the role of the product. So you should think of elements, mentally, you should think of elements of this n bar as being powers of a variable q. So you should think of them as being q to the n. And so, I mean, of course, I mean, then the product, I mean, you know, the correspond to the addition of the corresponding n. So you should think of them as q to the n. All right. So these are the two operations. The first operation is the infimum. And the second is the sum. And it's pretty obvious that when you act on this by multiplication, you preserve the two operations. Okay, it's compatible with the two operations, because of course, if I multiply two numbers, if I take the infimum, it's the same thing as taking the infimum of the multiplied, and the same for the sum. So what do we have? We have a topos with a sheaf, a structure sheaf, and we define this arithmetic site as being this pair, so a topological space, which is this topos, and a structure sheaf, which is this, which is viewed as a semi-ring in the topos.
Okay. Would you like to add zero to n bar?
No, because zero is coming from plus infinity. You see, when I say it's q to the n, q is smaller than one, so infinity will give me zero.
So the non-unitals.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So no, the unit corresponds to n equals zero. You see, q to the zero is one.
No, you want to add q to zero as well, yeah?
No, but when I write n, I include zero. This is a French notation.
You should remind the non-French part.
You see. N includes zero.
Okay. N cross is not multiplicative.
Right.
It's completely confusing.
Sure, I know.
N cross is not multiplicative.
It is multiplicative.
No, but the semigroup operation
cross is zero addition.
No, multiplication, of course.
But it's positive numbers.
Positive numbers, strictly positive.
Okay. But the other n is not strictly positive. So n
no.
Is two different
sure. Sure.
Well, that's not fundamental.
Yeah, okay. But I mean, I like to confuse people, because then, you know, they understand better, okay? So, okay. So let me write this, okay? So my topos is n cross, and this contains 1, 2, et cetera, okay? And the structure sheaf is n bar, and this n bar contains 0, 1, 2, et cetera, and infinity. Okay? And here we are. And they are both countable, okay? So that's the structure. This is the structure. Okay, so, and you should think of n bar as being q to the power n. Okay, of course. All right. Okay, so now what we are going to find, the first thing that one finds is that when you look at the points of this topos, you find a non-commutative space. This is the first surprise, because it doesn't use the structure sheaf. It's really only the topos. And there is a definition of a point of a topos, which is very simple. It's due to Grothendieck. What is the point of a topos? It's a geometric morphism from the topos of sets. So the topos of sets is the simplest possible topos. You take all sets, okay? That's, if you want, it's functors from a point to sets, but I mean, this is all sets, okay? So that's a topos. And a point in general, a definition of a point of a topos is a geometric morphism from the topos of sets to the topos that you consider. So here we consider a geometric morphism to this topos, And this data.
What do you mean geometric
morphism? Well, a geometric morphism, you see, when you take two topological spaces, and if you take a continuous map from x to y, it induces two maps on sheaves. It induces a push forward and a pull back. And they are adjoint functors. And moreover, the interesting piece is the pullback. It's not the push forward, because the pullback has an additional property. Not only it's commuting with arbitrary inductive limits because it's an adjoint, but it also commutes with finite projective limits. And that's a crucial fact. That's an absolutely crucial fact, because it's what governs everything in shift theory, the fact that you commute with finite projective limits. OK, so that's what you have here. And so in particular, this is what.
What do you mean geometric?
Oh, so a geometric morphism between two topoi, yeah. It's a pair of adjoint functors.
A pair of adjoint functors.
Okay, which go in, and such that the pullback functor is actually exact.
It's a pair, not one functor, but pair.
No, it's a pair. But it turns out by general theorems of category theory that you only need to know the pullback part. It determines the push forward part. Okay, so here, if you want, you are only interested indeed in this pullback part. Okay, which is left exact, and I mean it doesn't take much. Work to determine this pullback part by the following. So you don't need to know the pullback part everywhere. It's enough to know this pullback part when you restrict it to the composition with a Yoneda embedding, because there is a Yoneda embedding, as usual, of the original category in the topos. And when you compose with a Yoneda embedding, what you find is that you find something which is quite simple, namely you find really a functor from this small category n cross to sets, but it has to satisfy an additional property, which is a flat, which is to be flat. Okay. So what does it mean to be flat? It turns out that the first thing that it means is that the corresponding set is non-empty. And the second, and two other things, I mean, the second thing is the following, is that if you take two elements in the set, they will have a common root. So if you want, they will be written as the application of this functor to the same element, but with, of course, different values of k and k prime here. Okay, so this is the first property that you find. So, and the second property that you find is that, in fact, the action of n cross on this set x has to be free, in the sense that if the same element is sent by k and k prime to the same target, then the kn has to be equal to k prime. So these are the two properties. This follows from the definition of flat functors. You can read it in SGA. You can also read it in a book which is much more accessible, which is a book by MacLean and Mordyke on topos theory, which is more modern in a sense. Okay, but I mean it's all in SGA. I mean, you know. Okay, so I mean this is what you have to look for. You have to look for such. Flat functors, okay, and what you find out after it's really an exercise. So what you find out is the following: you find out that this category of points, so the flat functors, if you want, of this topos n cross, is in fact canonically equivalent to a category of totally ordered groups, H H plus, which are groups of rank one. So if you want, they are isomorphic to non-trivial subgroups of Q. And they are ordered, so they are subgroups of Q, so they inherit the order of Q, of course. So they are ordered groups, totally ordered groups. And the morphisms between two such ordered groups are the injective morphisms of ordered groups. Okay. And how do you see that? How do you see that? You see that as follows. I told you just in the page before that if I have two elements, x and x prime, they can be written of the form p of k times z and p of k prime times z for the same z. So you define the addition to be simply p of k plus k prime times z. Okay? So now you see you had an action of the multiplicative group. Now you use the addition in the integers to define a sum. And what you will find out is that it is independent of the choice of the element z that you have here. The independence of the choice of z follows because if you have another element, you can put another element below the two of them, and then it will work out. Okay, it will show you that you have the same sum. So the sum is well defined in the set X. And what you find after a while is that your set that you are considering is not, of course, the full group, but it's the strictly positive elements in the group H. So, and also, you know, because of the fact that every finite set of elements can be written as the image of a single element, what you find is that this group is, in fact, an inductive limit of rank one groups, I mean, of groups of the form Z. So then you find easily that it's a subgroup of Q and that it's ordered. It's ordered because you have the positive part, okay? So that's the first observation.
When you say it's isomorphic, is yes. the group to which it's isomorphic unique up to scaling?
In Q, yes, up to scaling in Q. And we are going to see that. In
so, exactly. we could, so you could have an Easter description, forget all this. It's all about the order. It's in Q.
Yeah, exactly.
You could just say it's a rank on something.
Exactly. Q, up to scaling. That's okay. perfectly correct. Okay. And this is what I'm going to use now. Because indeed, I have an adelic description, which is very simple, of rank 1 subgroups of Q, which is the following. It's easy to see that any rank 1 subgroup of, I mean, any subgroup of Q, non-trivial, can be written in the following way. It's a set of elements of Q such that AQ belongs to the hat, where A is an adel. Okay, where A is an adel. So you find an adel. This adel is not quite unique. It's unique only up to the hat cross. But it's easy to see that this is what you get, okay? And because of that property, that a subgroup can be associated to an element in this quotient of AQF mod the hat cross, and as you were saying, we are looking at them up to isomorphism in Q, so in fact we get a double coset space, which is the quotient of the adels by Q cross plus and by the hat star, okay? So, I mean, this was the first int, and these are finite adels, of course, okay? These are finite adels. Okay, so this was the first int because this is a non-commutative space. This is not an ordinary space. What do I mean by a non-commutative space? I mean a space where if you drop the uncountable axiom of choice, you will not be able to construct a bijection with a continuum. So it's a set for which, if you want, the cardinality is actually larger than the cardinality of the continuum, the effective cardinality. Okay, and of course this set I knew very well.
So in naive sense means talking of action is kind of transitive.
It's ergodic. Okay, I mean the fact if you want that the action of Q plus
more
cross.
Classical, that is true.
Sorry.
Classical to usual spaces, but the other way is really good space.
Sure, exactly. So this is not usual space. By any means, okay? So that was the first int. But of course, I mean, when I am dealing with this, I am just dealing with the points, okay, of the... So I, as I said, you know, it follows from this fact, I mean, it follows from this fact that any non-trivial subgroup can be written this way, and that, you know, you have isomorphic points if and only if they have the same class in the quotient, okay? So the, but one remains a little bit unsatisfied with this because this is not the space which I had found for... the zeta function, the space which I had found for the zeta function was not this one, it was a space without the finite adels, with all adels. Why it is very important to have all adels? Because then you have a flow, which is the action of R plus star, which will commute with everything. And you need a flow, of course. Okay. So, I mean, at that point, it's a little bit, it's just saying, you know, there is a hint of non-commutativity, but I mean, that's all you can say. Okay. So the next point now is really to let into play a fundamental semi-field, which is not B, but which is a semi-field which has been used very much in two different frameworks, I think. It has been used in the Russian school of dequantization, and it has been used in tropical geometry. And this semi-field, let me denote it multiplicatively. I much prefer to denote it multiplicatively. So it's R plus max. What is R plus max? It is, if you want, 0 infinity. It is 0 infinity. I do not include infinity. Okay. I use on 0 infinity the usual multiplication. So it's usual multiplication. Okay. And I use for the addition the max. So now x... sup y, okay, this is the max of x and y. Okay, so let me convince you in a few words, summarizing a few of the discoveries of people on that, why this is a very interesting object, even though, you know, it looks very simple. The thing that convinced me that it is a very interesting object is the following, is that if you develop the theory where you don't think of real numbers and so on, but you replace by R plus max, then you can wonder what is Fourier transform. And when you do that, you find the Legendre transform. So that's really a beautiful thing, because normally the Legendre transform, we know it's very useful, but we don't know where to put it, in which draw to put it. And it's just Fourier transform in this setup. So moreover, this...
It's actually discovered by Boltzmann's theory. Much over, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, sure, I'm sure that one.
Claim it exactly.
Sure, yeah. But in fact, what I would suggest actually to a student, you know, to do the following. I mean, this language of R plus Marx is the correct language for thermodynamics. And somebody should rewrite all of thermodynamics using this R plus.
Nobody, if you look long for the lecture, essentially it's done. Yeah,
yeah, okay. But sure, but I mean, somebody can do it with a lot of care.
I'm done 68, yeah. You can use large deviation. Okay. Yeah.
Fine. This all goes in the right direction, okay? So not only, but of course, you have one very important property, okay, which is that this R plus Marx contains what will play the role in this theory of the finite field FQ for Q equals 1. And I mean, this cannot be simpler. It's just formed of 0 and 1 with the rule that 1 plus 1 is 1. And this is what we call characteristic 1. Characteristic 1 is not 1 equals 0. I mean, that would be bad. Okay? But it's 1 plus 1 equals 1. Okay, so that's what you have here. That's what you have. And moreover, okay, it's an exercise also to show that this semi-field doesn't have any finite extensions, but in fact, so it has this infinite extension. And moreover, in that extension, which is R plus Marx, this is the beauty of the thing, you have a one-parameter group of Frobenius automorphisms, which are given by the map X goes to X to the power lambda. So if you look for the group of automorphisms of this semi-field, what you find is that for every lambda you have this Frobenius automorphism, and moreover they form all the automorphisms, okay, and their fixed point is equal to B, okay. So you see this situation is to be thought of as a parallel situation of what happens, of course, in finite characteristic when you take the algebraic closure of FQ, okay. So now the next step is to consider the points of our gadget on this R plus Marx, okay? On this R plus Marx, okay? And when you do that, actually, so this is what we found. We found that when you look at the, so what does it mean, first of all, a point now defined over R plus Marx? You see, when you do scheme theory, you will find out easily that when you are taking the points of a scheme over a local ring, essentially, so what this is given by, it's given by a point of the scheme, because after all, the local scheme, if you want a scheme corresponding to the local ring, will have only one point, essentially. So it will give you one point of the scheme, but it will also give you a local morphism which goes backwards, so which goes from the stalk at the point in the other way. Okay, and I think I didn't talk about the stalks, so let me tell you very briefly what are the stalks of the structure shift. This is very important for what I am going to say now, because you see, the beauty of the theory of toposes is that the stalks, so what is the point of a topos? A point of a topos is really the functor that gives you the stalk of a shift at that point. Okay, you should think of it this way. And the beauty of the functor which gives you given a shift, the stalk of the shift at that point, is that this functor commutes with inductive limits, arbitrary, but it commutes with finite projective limits. And the fact that it commutes with finite projective limits is crucial, because it tells you that, for instance, if the shift has a structure of semi-ring and so on, the stalk will also inherit the same structure. Because what you can say, for instance, is that the structure is given by a map from the product to the thing and so on. That will continue to work for the stalk. Okay, so we know a priori that the stalks have to be semi-rings. Okay, and we have to discover what they are, and we discover what they are by the following theorem. So the theorem, we know that the points of the topos are associated to subgroups, okay, to ordered groups. I mean, so abstractly to an ordered group, and so it turns out that when you compute the stalk of the structure shift, what do you get? Well, you take this ordered group and you make it into a semi-ring. And how do you make it into a semi-ring? Well, exactly in the same way as what we were doing for the integers, but you change the sign. So you use the max now, not the mean, and you add not plus infinity, but minus infinity, because okay, this will fit with standard notations, and so what you do is you take your ordered group, you add minus infinity, you use the max, okay, and use the plus as an operation for the product. But of course, you should think of it multiplicatively. So you exactly as I was explaining for the case of n. Okay, so what do we have? We have now a very good understanding of the stalk, of the sheaf, and we get in that way. This is not difficult to see. You get sort of all possible, under quote, algebraic extensions of what is called Zmax. So Zmax is a semi-field. It's very used in tropical geometry. And in that way, you get all possible algebraic extensions. Okay, and the maps, the relative maps, are the maps of semi-fields. And of course, there are two things which are important to say at this point. There are two things which are very important to say. The first one is that you have a semi-ring. We had the semi-ring n bar. What is it? Well, it's just the stalk of the sheaf over the simplest group, which is Z. Okay, so this is quite simple to see. But there is another thing which is quite important, you know, which is that at some point we shall need to have what in geometry is the field of functions, you know, of the function field. And when you look at the various definitions of the function field, you find out that there is only one which works in this case, and this is the stalk at the generic point. There is no other definition. And it's good that Grothendieck was insisting on this property, because here there is a generic point, and the generic point corresponds to the subgroup which is Q itself, because any other group will go inside. So this is a generic point. And so there will be a stalk at the generic point. Okay? So that's where we stand. And so now we can look at the... Now, because we have the stalk and that the stalk is a semi-ring, we can find out, we can compute what are the points over... And for simplicity, we prefer to take the points over the maximal compact subring of R plus max. But I mean, it would be easy to know what it means if you don't take that.
And what's the, what's the semi-ring associated to that generic point? Is it like
no, Q2? It's Q. It's Q, but you have to think of Q as being the exponent of a variable. Okay, so it's like arbitrary roots of a variable. Okay, rational roots. Okay, okay. So so what we find is the following. We find that when you compute the points defined over this R plus max, which is the maximal compact subring, in fact, okay, then of this tropical semi-field, then you find exactly that it is in bijection with the non-commutative space, which I had considered, okay, which is the quotient of the adels, the full adels now, divided by Q cross and divided by Z hat cross. And the division by Z hat cross, when I add, we shall see what is its relevance later. I mean, its relevance is to select among the various L functions with gross n character the Riemann zeta function. This is why this is exactly what one needs. Okay, and moreover, when you look at the action of the Frobenius automorphisms, which are automorphisms of this R plus max, so they are exactly the way you do the computation when you do algebraic geometry. So when you look at the action of the Frobenius automorphisms on these points, they correspond exactly to the action of the ideal class group modulo Z hat cross, so it's just multiplicative numbers, on this non-commutative space. And when you look more carefully, you find that this non-commutative space, so the space in question, is disjoint union of following two spaces. So there is the one that was coming from the finite adels. And when you look, this corresponds to the points here, which are not only defined over R plus max or over the maximal compact subring, but which are in fact defined over B. So this is very natural, you see. You have and they correspond to the fixed point of the Frobenius. And that's exactly what happens in the adel class space. So they correspond exactly to the fixed point of the Frobenius. And then you have another piece, and that other piece corresponds to those points which are not defined over B, and they are in fact in bijection with rank one subgroups of R. So, I mean, it's a fact which doesn't take much thinking that if you look at the space of rank one subgroups of R, it's a non-commutative space. Okay, by rank one subgroup, I mean groups such that any two elements are proportional by an integer. Okay, and it's pretty much like a space of leaves of a foliation. I mean, because you cannot find a canonical element there. So the way it occurs, if you want, the way the relation between this and the adels is very simple. It occurs by this simple formula here, where you have a simplification by Q. Okay, so that's where we stand. And now, what we want, of course, we want to relate this to the Riemann zeta function. And then, okay, this is a relation with the previous work. And so in order to do that, because the counting is extremely delicate, so what we do is we now consider this space of points, and we consider this scaling action, which was given by the action of the Frobenius on points. And now we consider complex valued function, and we count the number of fixed points by taking traces of operators. Okay, so in other words, we consider this group acting on functions on the Hadel class space. And what I had shown, okay, and which was then refined in particular by Ralph Meyer and so on, what I had shown was that, okay, one could understand the explicit formulas in terms of a trace formula, but the important part was the following. The important part was that, in fact, you can compute the trace of integral of these scaling operators, and they are given by this expression in terms of Hadels and Hidels and so on. And in this expression, you can see immediately that you have exactly the terms that Weyl introduced when he gave the conceptual understanding of the explicit formulas.
What is the measure involved? You say, what is these things, what is the measure there?
Which?
To integrate a certain measure on the right hand side. Yeah, what is the measure?
Yeah, you mean? This is du over u. This is du over u. I am working with functions of u because the Frobenius depends on a real number. So I am integrating over. Okay, I will explain more about this. Okay. So in fact, we apply this formula, but we apply it to functions which are invariant under z at star, because to get the Riemann zeta functions, you have to take the trivial Grossian character. So we take functions which are invariant under z at star. We take that function. And what it does, it gives us a distribution, n of u, on u belonging to 1 infinity, which is counting the number of fixed points, here, of course, in a very subtle way, of this Frobenius action on points. Okay. And now, the first result that we have is that this counting distribution of the Frobenius action, in fact, it's given by the following formula. It's given by n of u equals u plus 1. This would correspond to projective space, minus the derivative in the sense of distribution of the sum over the non-trivial zeros of zeta of the order of the zero multiplied by u to the rho plus 1 over rho plus 1. And if I was careless, if I would differentiate each term, I would get exactly the formula that you have for finite fields, for function fields. Namely, I would get u to the power rho. Okay, but I cannot do that. This sum exists as a function. Okay. But it doesn't exist when you differentiate. It exists only as a distribution. Okay. So that's what you find for this distribution, n of u. The second thing that you find is that it's positive. It's a positive distribution for u belonging to 1 infinity. There is a notion of what is a positive distribution. And the most surprising thing is that its value at 1 is minus infinity. You see, I have to explain why this was needed and why this is something which was looked totally impossible. Why was it needed? It was needed because it's known that the value at 1 of a counting function in the case of function fields is the Euler characteristic of the curve, say. Okay. But here, okay, imagine whatever curve this is. It has certainly infinite number of dimension for H1. And H0 and H2 are of dimension 1. So, I mean, it's totally improbable that the Euler characteristic would be something like 0 or something finite. It has to be minus infinity. And so this is what happens. This is what happens when you compute this function. And I can show you graphically what it does. So graphically...
Say again what the meaning of this function. Yes. What's the meaning of this function? It's counting fixed points or what is
it? N of u? Yeah, n of u is, as I said, obtained by the trace formula. Okay, so it's a distributional trace of this operator here, which is computed here. So it's a distribution. Okay, that's where the analysis comes in. Of course, you know, it's not counting in a naive manner. Of course.
Okay. Yeah, but what is it counting in a naive manner?
In a naive manner, what you would do is okay. This is again a subtle point. I mean, what you would do, you take the points of this topos and so on. Okay, and you would count how many fixed points you have for theta of u. Okay. Exactly. But now, you see, there is a big, big difference with the case of function fields, which is, in the case of function fields, the Frobenius, there are intermediate subfields. And you can look at the points with values in the intermediate subfield. There is no intermediate subfield here. Okay? And this we knew for a long time. Okay? So I mean, the count has to be global. Okay? It cannot be by looking at the points of our intermediate subfields. They are known. Okay? So this is what you get. And the graphic of the primitive, okay, because as I said, you know, it's best to think of it as a derivative, this distribution. When you plot the graphic of the primitive, what do you find? You find that you can approximate it by not taking the sum over all zeros of zeta, because this is impossible, but by taking the sum over finitely many zeros of zeta. And then you get this approximation, which is wiggling and so on. And what you find out is that, in fact, this function j of u, it doesn't look on the graphic, but it shoots down to minus infinity, and it has a finite value at 1. So when you take its derivative, the derivative is minus infinity at 1, but it's positive everywhere because the function is increasing. Okay? So for u positive, it's positive. All right, so this is what we have. But now there is a question which is troublesome and which we have to answer, which is that, is it possible to associate to this counting distribution an Acevalle type zeta function? Because this is what happens in the case of function fields. We really have an Acevalle formula. And for that, we start with the formula which had been given by Christophe Soulet. And what Christophe Soulet had done, he had considered geometry in characteristic 1, and he had found that there was a way to define a limit when q goes to 1 of the Acevalle formula. And his technique was the following. His technique was that you take the Acevalle counting formula. Okay, so this is a generating function. N of q to the r is supposed to be a number of points over the field corresponding to q to the r. So you take this function, and Soulet had the idea of taking the limit when q goes to 1. Okay, he has to renormalize this limit. He has to multiply it by q minus 1 to the Euler characteristic. And then he takes this function, but he couples the two variables, so he put t equals q to the minus s. Okay. And he computed it for instance, projective space. For projective space, the counting function is n of x. If you take n-dimensional projective space, it will be 1 plus x2 plus x to the n. So it's easy to compute, and you find the right answer, the expected answer, okay, which is a rational function of s. Okay, so this is what Soulet was proposing, but you see immediately that we have a big problem with the formula of Soulet because our Euler characteristic was minus infinity. Okay, so at first, when you try to apply this formula naively, you meet a wall. Okay, and because n of 1 is minus infinity, and however we have solved this difficulty, we solved this difficulty in the following way. What we have found, you know, moreover, if you take the definition of Soulet, there is no good idea why you should have a limit to this formula. I mean, this formula could very well not have a limit. Now, what we found is that this formula is, in fact, the Riemann sums for an integral. And how does this go? Take this formula and imagine that you want to eliminate this q minus 1 to the chi. How do you do it? You take the logarithm. The logarithm will put this term as an additive term. This term is independent of s. So when you differentiate with respect to s, it will drop out. Okay, so what you have to do is to take d by ds of log of zeta n of s. If you do that, the log in the, will counter the exponential, and you will just get this sum here. Imagine that I take this sum, and I replace t to the r by q to the minus s, and I differentiate with respect to s. Then there will be an overall minus sign, and there will be the r will drop out, because it was in the power, and I claim I will get the Riemann sums for a Riemann integral. Okay, because what you get now, as I said, you know, you take the derivative with respect to s, the r will drop out, you will get a log q, you will get a log q, and in fact, what I claim is that these are exactly, of course, the Riemann sum for the integral, which is the integral from 1 to infinity, of n of u times u to the minus s, because of this, times du over u. It is a multiplicative R measure, because you have the log q. Okay, so that's what you get. And then, because of that thing, now you can completely eliminate the problem that q is minus infinity, and you can say that if you have a counting distribution, you can associate to this counting distribution an Acevalle zeta function obtained as a limit when q goes to 1, but this is better to take as a definition. So if you want, it's a distribution, so there is no Riemann sum. It's something which is more subtle, but still, this integral will make sense, and this will define the logarithmic derivative of the corresponding zeta function. So this is really the definition, if you want, of the Acevedo zeta function. And it combines the idea of Soule with this fact that, that we have the Riemann sums, okay, for the...
Can you make a, can you define the function itself? Because, so this is up to
Well, this is up to a constant, yeah. I don't know. Well, I didn't really try because, one would have to. I thought a little bit about it. It would be good to actually do it, you know, up to a scale. I mean, to find it up to scale, it's like a finite value one. Okay.
How does n of u look at
it? Sorry.
So for Kultnik and n of u, because I didn't really understand the definition, but some transform of n of u is an ordinary function, it's a perfect view.
A
known function,
sir. Yes. So, no, but that's exactly what I'm going to say now. So what I am going to, what I'm saying is that our n of u, which you obtain, it's exactly what you are asking. Our n of u, when you do this formula, what you find exactly is the logarithmic derivative of the complete Riemann zeta function, okay, with the Euler factor. With the factor.
In that case,
that's exactly, okay? So we take it, we do it, okay? And so we can state that the Acevedo zeta function of the arithmetic site is this complete Riemann zeta function where it has also the factor at infinity. And it's easy to see also that the arithmetic site is a complete, it's complete. Why? Because you can look at global sections of the structure shift, you find they're known. Okay, so it's not missing a point or anything like that. It's a complete thing. Okay, so now of course we are only at the beginning, and what we want are the Frobenius correspondences, and we want the square of the arithmetic site. Okay, and the square over what? Well, the square over this B, okay, over this spec B, if you want, which is playing the role of, very, very, very basic. Some people call it F1, but okay. I mean, so that's what we want. We want the Frobenius correspondences. And the main result that we found is that even though the arithmetic site is countable, you see, because the arithmetic site is countable, you could totally give up the idea that there would be a one-parameter group of automorphisms. It cannot be. Cannot be. Things cannot move continuously. However, what we shall find is that if you think about correspondences, then it indeed has a one-parameter group of correspondences on the square. Okay, and they are exactly the ones we want. So in order to do that, we have to find the square. And to find the square, we use tropical geometry ideas. So we take the tensor product over B of this Semiring n bar. Okay, and to tell you what happens, you see, of course, you can always, as always, you can represent elements in the tensor square by tensor products of this type. Because we are in characteristic one, there is no coefficient here. And what you find also very easily is that there are simplification rules. For instance, if I take, if I take something like, if I take something like Q2 times Q3, plus Q times Q, well, I can cancel out this thing. And so it's equal to Q times Q. Okay, so what happens geometrically is the following. What happens, I will tell you the proposition later, but what happens geometrically is very clear, is that whenever you have a tensor, this is like Q times Q6, okay? So whenever you take a tensor, then all the elements which are in the yellow quadrant above it do not play any role. So in fact, the elements in the tensor square can be thought of as the yellow sets which are here. And these yellow sets, if you want, the best way to think of them is that they are hereditary subsets for the ordering of n cross n, which is the obvious ordering, namely that the ordering where a pair is larger than a pair if both elements are larger. So for every partially ordered set, you get a B module, and just by this trivial operation of union, okay? So if you take the union, you get a B module. And then it turns out that you take this product ordering. And okay, then if you want, there is a statement, which is not difficult to prove, which is that the tensor product is really the tensor product, namely it's uniquely characterized by the universal property that if you take any other B module, and you take a bilinear map, then this bilinear map will factor through this gadget, yeah, through this tensor product. So there is a tensor product. There is a tensor product. And once you have this tensor product, you can begin. But one will begin slowly. Okay, we shall see eventually that the true tensor product will be related to Newton polygons. And so it will be a semi ring made of Newton polygons. Okay, that's what we shall see. But this is just a preparation. Okay, so this is just a preparation. And now that we have this, we, of course, at first it's just a B module. Now we have to make it into a semi ring. But the semi ring structure is forced upon you, because what you want is that the multiplication of these tensors gives you this property here. And what does it mean geometrically? It means that you take yellow sets like here and you add them. Okay, so the sum will be the union. They will still be of the same form, but the product will be the addition of them. Okay, and this will still be of the same form, of course. Okay, so that's what you get. And moreover, You have a two-parameter now family of endomorphisms on this semi-ring, because you can rescale the power A and you can also rescale the power B. Okay, and as we shall see, you know, there is a we shall have to improve a little bit this. I will explain why. So this is the n-reduced square. So the n-reduced square is a topos which is a cross of n. Okay, two copies. I mean the product, and it has this as being the structure sheaf. But as we shall see very soon, this structure sheaf is a little bit like if you had a scheme and you would take an unreduced scheme. So so we shall have to do this reduction operation. I will explain it in some detail. Okay. So this is what is explained here. What happens, if you want, is that this semi-ring is not what is called multiplicatively cancellative. It's like if it had the zero divisor, if you want. So because of that, okay, one will have to do a completely canonical operation on it, which is to make it multiplicatively cancellative, and we shall see how it works. Okay, so this is not really an important point. Now, what is really important now is to define the Frobenius correspondences, and they will of course go down to the reduced thing automatically. And to understand the Frobenius correspondences, we first understand the product. You see, the product can be seen geometrically. Of course, because n bar was a semi-ring, there is a morphism of semi-rings from n bar times b n bar to n bar. And what is it? Well, it corresponds to the product, of course, you know, when you do the product of this ni and mi. But because the sum in n bar was given by the inf, what you see is that this product is in fact given by q to the alpha, where alpha is the infimum of ni plus mi. And this has a very clear geometric meaning. What it means is that you take a yellow set and you take the parallel to the second diagonal which touches the yellow set. Okay, you take the first one which does it. This is the product. Okay? So this is pretty obvious, but it will guide us to define the Frobenius correspondences. Why? Because now we have the product, and we can compose the product with the two variable Frobenius on the both sides. Okay, so when we do that, what do we get? You see, we take this FR and M, which was raising QA and QB to some power. Okay, and what do we find? We find that in fact, the corresponding morphism, okay, can be written very simply. It can be written as the infimum, not of N plus M, but now of R, Ni plus Mi, where I is the ratio between N and M. It only depends on this ratio, okay? And the picture is like this now. Now we no longer take a line which was the parallel to the second diagonal. We take a rational line, like the blue line here, and we push it up until it touches the yellow set. And that gives us the corresponding map, okay? And what is important, it's exactly like when we do ordinary algebraic geometry. What is important in algebraic geometry when you define a correspondence is the ideal defining the subvariety. Here it's a congruence relation defining the subvariety. And the congruence relation is that two yellow sets are congruent if the blue line is the same. Of course, you can have many sets which have the same blue line. They will be congruent for that, okay, for that relation. So this is what is described here, okay, in great detail. And there is another thing which is quite amazing, which is that when you look at the image of this morphism here, you have to characterize the corresponding algebra. And then you find that it was already done by Frobenius. Namely, it's called the Frobenius problem. It's a problem of knowing which are the numbers which are a combination with positive coefficients of two positive integers, I mean, or more in general. And there the name of Frobenius is really, really important. And okay, so that's what you get. But now, you get immediately from this thing the extension to arbitrary positive real numbers, because after all, this infimum of alpha ni plus mi can be extended to real numbers. And when you extend it to real numbers, what you find is that on finitely many elements, finitely many yellow sets, it doesn't see the difference between a real number and its Diophantine approximations. But if you look at all possible yellow sets...
By the continuous chain,
By the continuous fraction. The best rational approximation, of course. You have to use that, otherwise it doesn't work, okay? So, and but now if you look at all possible yellow sets, of course, two different real numbers will give you different answers, okay? And, okay, so because I have little time now, let me go a little fast, okay? So there is this reduction. The reduction turns out to be passing to the convex hull. So there is a theorem which tells you that in general, for semi-rings, you have a reduced semi-ring, okay, which is obtained by reduction. And we computed it in our case. And what did we find? We find that, of course, if you take a convex set, it is multiplicatively cancellative. But what we found, which is more important, is that the homomorphism which takes the convex hull is exactly the reduction map, which is canonically defined. So this means what? And it has a universal property. So what it means is that the reduced square, which is really the important thing, what it is, it's a theory of Newton polygons. So the topos is the cross, is the square of this topos. It's the dual of n cross square. And the structure shift is a shift of semi-rings, which is given by Newton polygons. And what happens, to see the small nuance with the yellow sets, is the following, is that when you take, for instance, this element where I have this Q5 times Q3, this element will disappear when you take the convex hull because it's inside the convex hull, all right? But it was obvious already that when you take the Frobenius correspondence, I don't see the difference between a yellow set and its convex hull, okay? Of course, because you were taking the half plane. Okay, so that's what we have. And then the really important result are composition of correspondences, so you can define the composition of correspondences as we do normally by taking tensor products and all that, okay? And then there is a theorem, and this is the non-trivial part of the second part. So the theorem tells you that if you take two Frobenius correspondences and you compose them, if you take two real numbers whose product is not rational, then you get the corresponding Frobenius correspondence. Okay, so the composition of psi lambda with psi lambda prime is psi lambda lambda prime. However, when the product is rational, it's more subtle. And one can understand intuitively very easily why it has to be like this. The point is that if you take an irrational number, this irrational number is the corresponding correspondence is a little bit stable.
And for just yes. The angle of the line or the line?
So it is a line. What matters is where the line, the slope of the line is a lambda. This is given. Yeah. And then whenever you have a yellow set, you slide it up. Okay. So this is a map. Okay. This is a map. It's a map of semi-rings and so on. Okay. All right. So what happens then is the following: is that when the two numbers are irrational, so they have some robustness, but their product is rational, then you will not get the lambda lambda prime. You have to make this lambda lambda prime, which is rational, you have to make it stable. And for that, you have to compose it with the tangential deformation of the identity, which is a certain correspondence, which is quite simple. It's just adding an epsilon in the definition. And as a corollary of this, now we can compute the intersection number of two divisors of that form. So, of course, we shall be interested in divisors which are integrals of Frobenius correspondences in the square. And because of the composition law, you can now define the intersection number of two such correspondences by computing their convolution, their composition, if you want, and then intersecting it with the diagonal. And one uses the previous thing. And note also that it's not enough to have the Frobenius correspondences when you do the veil stuff. You need also the correspondence which is point cross the variety and variety cross the point.
So is this nu going to be the...
Yeah, of course. The nu will exactly give you the thing, okay? And as I said, in the veil thing, you need to have point cross and... Okay, and we have it here. Why? Because look at the picture. Look at this picture. In this picture, I was taking slopes, okay? But I can take the vertical slope and I can take the horizontal
slope. It's like this proof of the Riemann hypothesis for curves.
For curves, right? Of course. I mean, you know, I don't want to say it, because then if you say this, you know, you are out of the game. Oh. But of course, you know, what we have been missing for all this time was a geometric setup, okay? And of course, what we are missing still, and this is a big, big, big missing thing, is the Riemann-Roch formula. So as you know well, as you know very well, I mean, Matuk Tate and then Grothendieck wrote notes, okay, in which Matuk wrote in his memoir that in this paper they missed the boat, and Grothendieck got it. So as you know, okay, if you had the Riemann-Roch, then okay. But I think it's a very good motivation to try to develop a Riemann-Roch formula of suitable type, you know, in this framework. And I want to finish with one thing. I want to finish with the following fact. You know, my thesis teacher, Jacques Dixmier, studied my Compte Rendu Note with Katia Consani very much in detail. We celebrated his 90th birthday on the 26th of May. And last Saturday, he gave me a telephone call in which he pointed out to me a paper which he had written in 1967 that should be related to our Compte Rendu Note. So I looked at his paper, and his paper actually gave very quickly the meaning of this story in non-commutative geometry. So as being, you see, with Katia we had written papers in which we were using a word which many people had used. We called it the absolute point. What we are looking, okay, because of you know, the series of motifs and all that, okay, but we had no idea, okay. Now let me explain to you why in non-commutative geometry this is the right name and why it gives you this. And the reason is the following: you see, in non-commutative geometry, when you talk about a topological space, it's encoded by a sister algebra, and the idea of Gelfand, many people, you know, is that you will extend the ordinary topological space is not by topos but by taking sister algebras, okay. Now, what happens is that when you work with foliations, you find out that you shouldn't be that strict. Namely, two different sister algebras can correspond to the same space if they are Morita equivalent. So what really matters is the Morita equivalence class of an algebra. And then what you find, these are theorems of people working in sister algebras, is that in each Morita equivalence class of sister algebras, there is a unique representative which is stable. And what does it mean to be stable? It means that when you tensor the algebra by the algebra of compact operators in Hilbert space, there is only one such, you take the separable Hilbert space, okay, you get the same sister algebra. All right? You have to know that there is only one Hilbert space, okay, and only one algebra K. So the single point now, you see, it's not right to say a topological space is represented by C of X. No. A topological space is represented by C of X times K. Okay. So in particular, a single point is represented by this algebra of compact operators, by K. Okay. All right. Because it's up to Morita equivalence. And so up to Morita equivalence, the right algebra representing a point is K. Okay. So the single point is represented by this algebra K. And then, what do you find? That's an easy exercise. Is that when you look at the semigroup of endomorphisms of this C-star algebra, modulo inner automorphisms, which you always do in non-commutative spaces, you find exactly the semigroup n-cross. And how does it act? It acts on the compact operators by Frobenius type endomorphisms, which are essentially doing amplification. Namely, you have an operator, and you sort of repeat it, you put it inside of itself k times. Now you can organize this in such a way that it's an action of n cross on the compact operators by endomorphisms. It's compatible with the product, has all the properties. What does it mean? It means that in non-commutative geometry, we have Frobenius endomorphisms for any algebra because they are tensored by k, okay? And we have the structure of the point. And so as I said, you have a natural action. And what is the result of Dixmier in 1967, which put me into this? How can it be translated in our terms? You see, because now K becomes an involutive algebra in this topos, because it has this action of n cross. Okay, I am done. Okay, so now it defines a sheaf, so we can take the stock of the sheaf at any point of the topos. Okay, what we get is not a sister algebra because it's not complete; it's an inductive limit of sister algebra. So we can complete it. We get what is called an infinite separable matroid sister algebra. And by the theorem of Dixmier, what you find is that all the infinite separable matroid sister algebras appear in that way and once and only once. And Dixmier had noticed, reading our note, that the classification was the same. Okay? So I think this is a good way to end. Of course, we didn't discover this topos, not at all this way. We discovered it by the link between the arithmetic site and the epicyclic site, which has to do with cyclic homology and so on. So, I mean, you know, the route was totally different. But it's very satisfactory that, you know, we seem to be closing really on what is the point in the absolute point somehow. Okay, thank you.
Matroids,
yes.
They're not matroids.
No, they are not the matroids of Gelfand, yes. They are sister algebras, yes.
So what happened to the Euler formula? So if you select a thesis, where this can be additive, right? You have additive, so to speak, right? Representation of the function, right? Corresponds to additive. And what corresponds to the, if you look multiplicatively?
Oh, the Euler formula, because when you take the logarithmic derivative, of course you get a sum, you know, that's what it does, of course. That's why you get a sum over places.
But my question, if you try to apply to other zeta functions, so other fields, yes, for example, yeah?
Oh, this I didn't try. This we didn't try. You see, for other fields, people have generalized the Hadel class space and all that, but I'm not sure that this is the right way, because what was important in the, what I explained is that we get away from the Hadelic side. We go really to the algebraic geometry side. And to go to the algebraic geometry side for other fields, one will have to be extremely careful, extremely, you know, it will not just be, I mean, one could, you know, start from Hadels and all that, but I don't like that. I mean, the steps that we have crossed now is to be in algebraic geometry. It's algebraic geometry which is special, it's characteristic one and so on. You know, it will require a lot of work to develop it, but it's there. It's really algebraic geometry, and it's topos. And, you know, for me, it's an immense joy for the fact that Grothendieck, you know, invented this topos. I mean, you know, I find this idea marvelous, and I find that, okay, it has been used in mathematics, but its power is tremendous. Really.
No, I have just a guess. Yes. It's obvious guess. It's cluster. Mathematically, it's part of the story, yeah. Because we have all classical shapes, rational numbers, sure.
Exactly. Yeah. So let's pray that we can walk until the target, you know.